I think I can start.
Yeah.
Start. Yeah, today I'm going to tell you about the meanders. And in particular, I will say some properties of enumeration of meanders and about a new decomposition of meander, which I found recently. So let me start with some informal definition of meander. Let L be a line on a plane with n marked points. With n marked points. And let M be a simple smooth curve which intersects L transversally. I think I can write something like this. In precisely this, in this and in this and points intersected. This and intersect L in this n marked points.
Нужно писать these.
Да, these. Спасибо. Let me draw an example of meander. Something like this. This is L, this is M, this is double points. And the pair M and L is called meander, open meander. We say that two meanders are equivalent if they are, if there is an isotropy of the plane which sends M to M prime, L to L prime. So we consider meander up to isotropy of the plane.
You should be more precise, I believe. If you consider open meanders, then we always suppose that the right end.
Yes, thanks. That's why I said this definition is informal, because if we would like to make a precise formal definition of an open meander, it will be too long. That's why now I stop with this definition, and later in the talk I will make a more formal, correct definition of the meander.
Okay.
The answer is how many different.
That's a question.
Oh yes, sir. The question is how many. How many different meanders with n double points. Mn is a number of inequivalent meanders. Inequivalent meanders of order n.
Задача состоит в том, чтобы перенумеровать все меандры порядка n. И нужно сказать, что ни в каком разумном смысле она еще до конца не решена.
Yes, that's what I'm going to say. That firstly. Давайте я вот здесь n большой поставлю.
Оно должно быть четким? Нет,
нет, не обязательно. Sometimes we can consider closed meanders, then L is a closed simple curve, and so it's always have an even number of crossings with L. And when we are saying about open meanders, it can be it can have even odd number of crossings. For example, this is also a meander.
Левый конец всегда идет
влево. Да, ну бесконечно.
Отчетности вправо либо вниз, либо вправо вверх.
Да, да, да. Окей. a bit about history of this question. Apparently, the first appear of meanders in mathematical literature was the paper of Poincaré, where he tried to use meanders to prove the theorem about the fixed points of the some kind of map from annulus to itself. And later, meanders appear in different areas of mathematics. Now it's well known that meanders are connected with Temperley-Lieb algebras, for example, then with some moduli spaces, and with, for example, models of statistical mechanics, statistical physics. Okay. There is only one meander with one crossing. There is only one meander with two crossings. There are precisely three meanders with three crossings, or two meanders with three crossings. This and this. With four, there are three of them. This, then. Thank you. Правый конец на бесконечность убегает, и левый конец тоже. В том смысле, что нету какой-то. Ну, нет. Mm-hmm. Так, вот так, потом. Значит, да. Этот, еще один. А, три, да? А, да, хорошо. Here all meanders up to four crossings. Well, as I said, meanders appear in different areas of mathematics, but the main questions about meanders are still unknown. For example, what can we say about these numbers? Are there any explicit formula? So yet there are no known any formula for MN. And okay, we don't know the exact formula for meander. Maybe we can say something about its asymptotics. С точностью до изотопии R2.
Изотопия плоскости, сохраняющая прямую. Ну, точки она может таскать по прямой. Это важно, чтобы прямая оставалась на месте. Там она может растягиваться, сжиматься, сдвигаться. Ну.
Are there any good estimates on the asymptotics? And unfortunately, we don't know the exact asymptotic, but there are some estimates, and we can, and there is a conjecture, stating that Mn is equal to c to the power n to the power alpha, where there are no good conjecture about c, and the there is a conjecture about alpha, where alpha equals 29 plus square root of 145 divided by 12. This strange number appears when we consider meanders as some two-dimensional conformal field theory with central charge minus 4, whatever this means.
What do you mean? The exponential term is much stronger.
Yes, yes, but there isn't.
You have no conjecture about C, but you have conjecture about.
Yes, yes. Yeah. It falls from some physical.
The change of C just covers this
area. Yes, yes, but I said it's it follows from the some physical ideas. I don't understand them, but. Да, я. Спасибо. But as I said, we can make some estimates on the growth rate. And now I will prove a very simple estimate on the growth rate of meander num. Let me move here. So
probably I must say that I do not believe in this value of alpha. I believe the conjecture itself, c to the power n times n to the power alpha, it belongs to myself and Sasha Zvonkin. Mm-hmm. But I do not believe into this value of alpha.
Well, there is no meaning to speak about alpha. C is unknown.
Okay. Let me define, first of all, the so-called closed meanders. A closed meander is almost similar, but L is a closed simple curve. Closed simple curve.
Not L, but N, probably. M.
Or, yes, sorry, M. Simple, closed simple curve. And so there are always even number of intersection between M and L. Here is an example of a closed meander. Now,
пишите, что это за closed meander.
Closed meander. Simple closed curve. Same line. Ну,
Что тогда это?
Yes. So, how we can get any? First of all, we can easily find that there is a connection between closed meanders and open meanders. For example, the M to N. Suppose that M over line N number of closed meanders. Meanders and double points. There is a connection that the number of open meanders with 2n minus 1 crossings or double points is equal to the number of closed meanders with 2n double points. This follows from the following construction. If we have an closed meander, we can forget about the last crossing, delete it, and make such an open meander. This procedure is a one-to-one correspondence, so we have that the number of okay, and there is one more connections between number of closed meanders and number of even meanders, stating that M to n less or equal n powers. This follows from the following observation. If you have a closed meander, we can construct we can forget about some of the marks which are if we have a closed meander, there are some number of arcs which are lie on the boundary of the unbounded component of if we delete the meander from the plane. So in this there are this arc, this arc, and this arc.
Maybe one should call them external.
Yeah, external arcs.
External arcs.
External arcs. And if we think about one of external arcs as the Okay, if we cut it and think that it's it is an open curve, we get an open meander, and the number.
But you need to put. To the left. You must add. No.
It's better to to cut the upper. The upper external arc, but now it's not interesting because. In this example, it's not interesting because we have only one external arc in the upper half plane. So, and the number of such external arcs is at most n. So we have this inequality. Dada. Тони. Но на сфере можно рассматривать две, как сказать, две окружности на сфере. Это то же самое, что просто замкнутый меандр, если я правильно понял вопрос. Нет. Здесь у нас фиксировано. Одна. Да, хорошо. Okay, now how we can get some estimates on the growth rate of meander numbers? So, as you can see. On the upper, if we have a closed meander, on the upper half plane, there are some configurations of semicircles. And there is a configurations of semicircles in the lower half plane. So the easy observation is that if we take any configuration of semicircles in the upper half plane, there is at least one configuration of semicircles in the lower half plane such that their union is a closed simple curve. This can be easily seen by induction, and maybe it's obvious. We can say that the number of closed meanders with two n crossings is bigger than number of such configurations, and the number of such configurations is a well-known Catalan numbers, C, n.
Значит, прямая L рассекает наш меандр на две конфигурации. В верхней полуплоскости имеется один набор полуокружностей, в нижней полуплоскости имеется второй набор полуокружностей. Количество полуокружностей с количество наборов полуокружностей с данным набором точек на прямой, с данным набором, концы которых лежат на данной прямой в данных точках, 2n концов, значит, это вы легко сосчитаете, это число Каталана, одно из определений чисел Каталана. Вот. И то, что Юра сказал, это то, что очевидно, что каждому набору таких полуокружностей в верхней полуплоскости можно сопоставить такой набор полуокружностей в нижней полуплоскости, что у нас получится из этих двух наборов полуокружностей одна связанная окружность, связанная кривая простая, пересекающая прямую в 2n точках. Вот поэтому оценка у нас, что число замкнутых меандров на 2n точках не меньше, чем число Каталана, nt число Каталана. Ну, может, вы напишите формулу для nt числа Каталана какую-нибудь, чтобы можно было представить себе.
I don't remember the exact formula, only the recurrence relation and the asymptotic of the
Catalan. One of the exact formulas is that it is the binomial coefficient n choose of 2n, число сочетаний из 2n по n. Поделенное еще на n плюс 1. Единица поделить на n плюс 1. N большое. Like that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we obtain a lower bound on the growth rate of the number of closed meanders, and it's obvious that it's there is upper bound, that is a square of the Catalan number, because we can take any configurations of semicircle in the upper half plane. We can take any configuration in the lower half plane. Sometimes we obtain a closed curve, sometimes not, but at least it give us an estimate. From this, we know that the asymptotics of the Catalan number is Mn. Four to the power n, n minus
n two n capital.
Yes, thank you. And so, if we consider this, if we want to somehow estimate this c from the growth rate, we need to consider the following limit: the root of power n of mn as n goes to infinity. Yes, from this relation, we easily get the following estimate on the open meander growth rate.
And this is exactly c.
Yes, this is c, of course. This is c.
Provided the limit exists.
For the meanders, I think it's proved that it exists, but I try to remember the proof, and I don't, honestly, I don't remember it. But the fact, this is the theorem that this limit is exists. And so we get an estimate on C is less than 2 as a square root of, and bigger than 2 and less than 4. Yes, so this is a first very easy estimate on the meander growth rate. At the moment, there are several more good estimates.
Better.
Better estimates. Let me write one of them. C. Here is. Some kind of.
Там только поставьте запятые, а то их.
Yes, it's to prove these inequalities. It's a bit harder, and so I won't do it now. Anything else? Yeah.
Whose estimates are they? Do you remember?
Yeah, I can see the authors. Alberta and Patterson.
Both the upper and the lower.
Yes, they consider meanders as some kind of formal language, and studying this formal language, when they obtain a lower and the upper bound on the meander growth rate. Okay. But now I would like to tell you about our recent development in this area, about the unique decomposition of the meanders, which lead us to some recurrence formula for meanders, meander number, in terms of some other numbers, so of irreducible, in terms of number for irreducible meanders, and now I need the formal definition of the meander. Okay, the open meander is the following set of data: D, P1, P4, P3, P4, P2, L and M, where D, D2 is a two-dimensional disk. P1, P4 are points on the boundary of the disk, such that there exists a connected component of the boundary of the disk minus P1, minus P1, P2, P1, P2, containing the set P3, P4. I will explain later why we need some this kind of restrictions. Then L and M are the images of proper embeddings of a segment of segment 0, 1 to into D2, such that they intersect only transversally in n double points. Points and L маленькая и L большая пересекаются трансверсально в n двойных точках, and dL is equal to P1, P3, dm equals to P2, P4. So, as I said, the formal definition of a meander is quite big. Open meander.
Вообще меандр это такая река Малой Азии, которая течет по песчаной местности, и поэтому у нее очень извилистое русло. И которая она к тому же еще и постоянно меняет.
So now we consider meanders not on the plane but in the disk. And now we don't say that L is a line, it's just a curve. So the example of a meander is this. This is P1, this is P2, this is P3, this is P4. I will always draw meander in such a way that L will be the diameter of the disk. The points point P1 is in the upper half plane, and it's close to the P2. Yes, here is M, here is L. And we say that...
Но P3 при этом может лежать и в нижней...
Yes, if there are even number of intersections P3 lie in the upper semicircle, and if there are odd number of crossings between M and L, P3 lie in the lower semicircle. And next, we say that meander M D2, P1, P4, Lm is equal to the meander M prime D4, D prime, P1 prime, etc. P4 prime, L prime, M prime, if there is a homeomorphism F from D2 to D2 prime, prime such that F of PE is equals to F is equal to the PE prime, F of L is equal to L prime, and so for M, M equals to the M prime. So this is a pure topological definition of the meander. So we take one meander and make some homeomorphism, which send it to the another one. Yes, we need some strange properties for P from the points P, because if we don't apply them, such meanders P1, P3 would be not equal to the. There is a more easy example. Consider this meander. This is P1. This is P2, or P3. This is P4. P2, P4 is not equal to the P3, P1. If we don't apply this property to be true. But as we supply these meanders, this is not a meander anymore. Okay. Yes. To introduce the decomposition of the meander, I need several definitions. One more definition is the is the following definition. Let M be a meander, open meander, meander, and a disk D prime is said to be значит, be in correct position. Correct.
Юр,
да?
С этого момента M это у вас не кривая, а меандра целиком, да?
Yes.
Вы
yes.
Вначале обозначали через M одну компоненту кривой.
Здесь да, я да. Вот маленький.
Ну, нет, ну... да.
We say that disk, disk, disk in correct position with respect to meander M, if D, D prime intersect M intersect L equals to the empty set, the cardinality of the set D prime intersect L equals to the D prime intersect L equals 2, and D prime intersect M intersect L more than 0. So let's make an example, look at the example of the disk which is in correct position with an open meander. For example, here, here we have a meander. Yes, we can consider such a disk. it is incorrect position with respect to because it intersect its boundary intersect M and L in precisely two points, and there are which are not double points, and there are some double points in the interior of this disk. There are other disks.
So this disk D prime must be a subdisk in D. Yeah?
Yes.
It's not just.
Indeed, yes. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Here are two examples of such disks in correct position with respect to. And we say that this number, the cardinality of this intersection, we called it the width of the disk. Width of D prime is equal to the D prime intersect M intersect L. Then we say that two disks in correct position with respect to open meander M is said to be equivalent if they contain the same set of double points of M in of M and L. Say that let D prime and D double prime disks in correct position, disks in correct position with respect to open meander M, some open meander M, and we say that D prime is equal to the D double prime if D prime M L equals as a set D prime prime M L. P2, P1, P4, L and M. It means, for example, that this disk is equivalent to this disk because they contain the same set of double points of M and L. If we have an open meander and we have a disk in correct position with respect to this open meander, for example, let M be a meander, open meander, D prime is a disk in correct position, disk in correct position with respect to M, then we can consider meander M как это сказать хорошо?
Restricted,
yeah. M restricted to the D prime is a well-defined meander. It consists of the following set of data. D prime, then P1 prime, etc. P4 prime, D prime intersect L, D prime intersect M. Where the points P1 prime, P4 prime obtained by the following procedure. We can orient the curve L and M if we take P. We can orient the curve M in such a way. We say that P1 is the starting point, P3 is the end point, and for example, in this disk, we get a meander in the following way. If we orient the M, the first point, the set of intersections between the boundary of the D prime and M is just two points. And there is a relation. We can say that one point is less than our other based on the orientation of the curve M. So if we consider meander in this small disk.
So P1 prime is the point where M enters
the disk first.
Yes. Yeah. And after.
And how do we choose P2 prime?
If the width of this disk is odd, then the choose of P2 is unique based on the property of the points. If the width of the disk is even, and if it is odd, we do the same procedure. We orient L from P2 to P4 and take the first point of intersecting between L and D prime as P2 prime. In fact, this doesn't matter, but we need to choose some specific procedure. So it's a well-defined meander.
Когда мы ограничиваем меандр на какой-нибудь диск в правильном положении по отношению к нему, то мы можем в этом диске, на границе этого диска, выбрать правильную нумерацию точек пересечения по 1 штрих, по 2 штрих, по 3 штрих, по 4 штрих, ну, более или менее зафиксировав, чтобы ориентация была такой же, как у исходного меандра.
Да. An easy observation that if d prime is equal to d double prime, then m d prime is equal to m d double prime. What we do we need more? So and now one more definition. Definition of the insertion of using this definition of disk in correct position and this definition of meander restricted to the disk, we can define how we can insert one meander into the other. For example, let M be a meander, D prime is a disk in correct position with respect to M, and M prime is another meander such that the number of double points in M prime denoted by I don't know N prime, the N prime is equal to the width of the disk D prime mod 2. So if there are two, if there are even number of crossings in D prime, then meander M prime also have even number of crossings. And so if odd, then M prime also have odd number of crossings. And we can insert M prime into M in D prime by the following. First, we delete, consider M. We delete this disk in correct position. I think maybe it's better to look at the example to make this definition more clear.
Значит, вы хотите вырезать диск, правильно расположенный диск, из существующего меандра и вклеить на его место другой меандр с той же четностью. С той же четностью количества пересечений. Да, ну, значит, эту операцию нужно назвать как-нибудь там замещением или...
Я назвал insertion.
Нет, но когда вы называете ее insertion, то вы вставляете как какой-то один меандр, а тут вы тут на самом деле есть два аргумента. Это меандр, который вы вырезаете, меандр, который вы вставляете. Поэтому ее правильно называть замещением. Там.
Да,
replacement, replacement of.
Да-да-да, наверное, да-да, действительно, наверное, лучше говорить, что это замещение, потому что дальше будет такой более понятная вещь. Let us consider an example. How we can insert, for example, this meander m prime to this disk? We just delete the part of the meander which is inside this disk and make a map from m prime to this in such a way that the obtained meander is indeed the indeed a meander. So to doing this, we need to specify the points p1, p2, p3, and p4. This here is in result of the replacement of this disk with a meander m prime. Yes. What's next? The idea of the decomposition is the following. We would like to find, take a, no, we would like to take some meander. We would like to find a sequence or a set of disks in correct position with respect to this meander and delete them or cut them in such a way that we obtain something simple and in such a way that this procedure is unique. So when I say we cut a meander, I mean the following. We say that
you wish to obtain a meander as a result of replacements of a sequence of replacements from some standard meander also.
Yes. Okay, if now I will try to describe this procedure, but before I specify some
some specific case or partial
case. Specific cases, thank you, of this insertion, of this replacement procedure. So if M prime has less than then three double points, we say that we cut, we say that we cut d prime from M. Yes, and the second, we say that if width of d prime is less than 3, we insert m prime into M.
Значит, как мы видели на картинке, есть ровно один открытый меандр с одной точкой пересечения, один открытый меандр с двумя точками пересечения. Поэтому там свободы никакой нет. И если мы вклеиваем меандр с одной или двумя точками пересечения вместо данного, то мы можем считать, что мы просто данные истребили. А если мы, наоборот, вместо такого меандра вклеиваем что-нибудь более сложное, то мы можем считать, что мы сделали такую вклейку, а там ничего не было.
Well. Now for let M be a meander, consider we can consider a graph of all equivalence classes of disk in correct position with respect to M in such a way that the vertices definition G M let M be a meander M is a decomposition graph decomposition graph if the set of vertices of GM is equal to the equivalence classes of D, I write it in this manner, where D is a disk in correct position with respect to M. To M. And the edges of this graph defined as follows. We say that there is an edge from D1 to D2 if there exists a disk D1 prime in the set of all equivalence classes of D1 and there is a D2 prime in такой что D1 prime is a subset of D2 prime. Let's consider an example.
Such a graph should be a tree, yeah?
No.
Nope.
Nope. Sometimes.
Not necessary.
Not necessary tree, yes. Let me draw an example. And let us calculate the number of all disks in correct position. There are disks in correct position which contain only the only one crossing. There are exactly n such disks. And another disks contain two points. This one.
Может быть, другого цвета их рисовать?
Да, давайте. This one. And this one. There is one disk which contains three points. Но цветов больше нет. So, let it be red again.
Опять красным можно.
Yeah, let it be red again. Yes, there is one disk which contains four crossings. Again, blue. There is no intersection here. And then one disk which contains all the crossings of the disk which contains the meander. And the graph will be the following. There are five vertices on the I will draw this graph on the vertices of this graph. I will draw on levels which correspond to the width of the disk who represent the vertex of this graph. So there is one, there is two, and there is here. Then we have this one, then we have this one, and we have this one. I need some edges, for example, from this to this, from this to this, because if there is, how to say it better?
По-русски скажи.
Ну, не все ребра рисую, чтобы слишком не загромождать картинку. В том смысле, что если мы...
There are too many edges. Yeah, but probably there is no need to draw. You have several natural layers in
yes.
your graph, levels, layers in your graph, and you may preserve only edges that contain that connect.
Okay, let me say it formally. We say that there is an edge E from edge from D1 to D2 if there exists such a disk first and
second if there is no intermediate
yes.
there are no intermediate disks.
There is no D3 such that there is an edge between D3 and D2. And there is no edge from D3 to D1. To D1. I think it's a bit...
It means that we consider only connected straws disk.
Sorry, will you repeat, please, louder?
When we consider disk, we take only connected straws. Ну вот связанные кусочки.
Чего?
Меандры, которые мы обрезаем.
У нас есть in the definition of a disk in a regular position, we require that the intersection of both curves with the boundary of the disk consists exactly of two points, which means that inside such a disk, the intersection is a connected curve. Значит, мы, когда определяли диск в регулярном положении внутри, а мы только такие диски рассматриваем, мы требуем, чтобы пересечение каждой из двух кривых меандра с этим диском состояло, с границей диска состояло из двух точек. А это означает, что кусочек каждой из кривых внутри диска, он связанный. Правда? Окей. Okay.
Yes, let's move on. We say that one more definition. We say that disk simplifies. Okay, let me write it somewhere here. Disk M is a meander. D is a disk in correct position with D prime with respect to M, and we say that D prime is simplifying if and the, if the prime is an articulation point calculation point in GM, and to D prime minus N. So let M be a meander with N crossings. We say, and the D prime is a disk in correct position with respect to this meander, and we say that D prime is simplifying M. If firstly, it is an articulation point in the graph, and the second property is that its width is bigger than 2 and less than N.
So, то есть, если мы заместим этот диск элементарным меандром нужной четности, то он упростит наш меандр.
Да, ну, по идее, мы могли в любом месте упростить, но чтобы процедура была... In theory, we could try to simplify our meander in each, in an arbitrary disk with... with this restriction on its width, but we want the simplification procedure to be unique, and so we need to add one more restriction that it's represent the articulation point in the decomposition graph. So
would you repeat, please, the definition of articulation point?
Yes, articulation point. The vertex is said to be articulation point if after deleting this point, our graph become disconnected. So in this example, there is only one articulation point. It's here.
Why is this true?
Yes, there is. This point is also an articulation one.
Yeah.
So.
And the eyes of the two below the first one, yeah.
But, yes, these are articulation points, but these disks are not simplifying because the width of the corresponding disks are exactly 2. So there is 2 articulation points in this graph. So then we are ready finally to describe the procedure how we simplify the meander. First of all, consider all. Let me write it somewhere. So let us start with a meander, and with let M be a meander. M meander. GM is its decomposition graph. The first step, consider all disks simplifying M. Simplifying M, we take such disks that there are no if we consider the graph which the rooted graph where root is this. Is this vertex? There are no other simplification. Ah, okay. I know the. We take set D such a set of disks D such that. M restricted to D has no simplifying discs. Has no simplifying discs. Simplifying discs. Discs. So in this example, there is only one such a disk because if we consider this meander, meander restricted to this disk, here it is. It has one more simplifying disk inside it. At the second step, we cut all disks from this set. I don't know. Let's take it as cut all disks from S. From S from meander M. And we obtain some meander M, I don't know, M1. And we can repeat this procedure.
Yura, just to, I would like to confirm I understand well what's going on. Is it true that any disk in a regular position can be considered as a disk centered at the diameter?
Yes.
Yeah, that's true.
So the procedure is this. Let's see what how we can simplify this meander. The first, the set S consists contain only one element. This disk. After we cut this disk, we obtain a meander with decomposition graph. The following, there are no disk simplifying M in this decomposition graph. And so the procedure stops here. So the only interesting question remains is what are the meanders that have no disk simplifying it?
Excuse me. Could you repeat the first step of your procedure?
Yeah.
In this example, how does it work?
Yes, we in this example.
Yeah.
Okay, we consider the set of disks simplifying M, which simplifying M such that there are no disks simplifying N in the meander restricted to this disk. So in this example, it is there is only one such a disk. Here it is. On the picture, it's a disk containing one, two, three, these three crossings. Because
okay.
If we take a disk which contains four crossings, the restricted meander
a sub-disk.
So, yes, there is a sub-disk which is simplifying.
Yeah, I see. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, and yes, the only question remains is what are the meanders which has no disk simplifying it? And there are two classes of such meanders. The first meanders are snakes, and we have already seen them. Let me give an example. Consider.
Напишите слово. Snakes.
Yeah. Snakes. Snakes. The decomposition graph of such a meander will look the following. We have exactly 3, 4, 5, 6. We have exactly n disks on the first level, n minus 2 disks on the second level, and so on. N minus 2 on the third. Such a and as you see, there are no articulation points in this graph. So, and there are no disks simplifying M. The other example of there are two types of snakes. This is a direct snake, and an inverse snake. It starts from the bottom and Okay. Inverse snake. Inverse snake. We can say that how many snakes of a given order there are. There are two distinct snakes if number of crossings are odd, and there is only one snake if number of crossings are even. Something like this. There is only one snake such. Okay, and what about the other case of meanders which are not simplifying, and they are the most interesting one. Let's call it irreducible meanders. Definition. Meander M is irreducible if there are no disk D prime in correct position with respect to M, such that the following inequality holds. And so there are no disks simplifying M, and the decomposition graph of irreducible meander looks like a tree. Let's use the following notation. M and E is the number of all irreducible meanders, meanders of order.
Is there a constructive way to describe all irreducible meanders?
Unfortunately, no. If we have such a way, we could enumerate meanders up to
very
effectively. Yes. Order. So this. Let me say some words about this decomposition. So if we have this decomposition, it's not hard to prove that this decomposition is unique. Yeah, because at each step we delete the lowest articulation point. And we can inverse this procedure into the procedure of constructing meanders from irreducible and from snakes. In such a way, we take a reducible meander or a snake, we find some number of disks in correct position with respect to this meander. We insert insert some other simple meanders, snakes, or irreducible, and so on. We can, it's not difficult theorem that this procedure could be also make. We could add some constructions to make this procedure also unique, and so we obtain a recurrence formula for the number of meanders of n or less crossings in terms of number of irreducible meanders, because the number of snakes are known. I can write it formal, but it's so big that I don't want to do it. Yes.
It's written.
Yeah, it's written. No, it's really big because we need to sum over partitions of the numbers. I don't know. Nearly eight sums. Nearly.
Summons.
Summons. Yeah. No sums. I mean. Let me draw a part of this formula. То, что показывал, это простой вариант, когда мы без irreducible, без неприводимых, там только змейки. А вот где с неприводимыми, там, конечно. Ну, the formula looks. Сейчас я ее найду. Sum. Here is number of irreducible meanders, m, e, m, m, Здесь у нас стоит некоторая такая function tau. No, I need to add a lot of new definitions to write it, and so it was.
These are some combinatorial factors. Yes. Computable combinatorial factors.
Yes, yes, yes. This is some combinatorial computable factors. I said this formula is big. It's take more than one page, I think. Yes. Let's move on. Move back to the irreducible meanders. And now I will write some numbers of reducible meanders to the first for the small n. It's the following. There are zero reducible meanders with a small number of crossings, 0, 0, 0, 0, 2, 2, 0, 0. As you see, we have, for example, for 11 crossings, there are more than 1,000 different meanders, and none of them are irreducible. Let me draw an example of an irreducible meander, for example, here. Here is an example of a reducible meander. If we try to find...
It has eight crossings, yeah?
Yeah, eight crossings. As you can see, there are only two meanders, irreducible meanders with eight crossings, and the other one...
is its mirror image.
Yeah, is its mirror image. So, the only disks are disks with one crossing inside, and there are three disks with two crossings, and it looks something like this. Maybe we need to. Maybe we need to change the number of. No, it doesn't matter. The graph is isomorphic to this one. The interesting.
Excuse me.
Yes.
The question is, if we take the meander of size 3, for example.
Yes.
Is it irreducible? Why does it?
Two meanders of order 3, and both of them are snakes. And the
So we don't want them to be snakes?
Yes.
Snakes are not irreducible because...
The case with the 3 crossings is somewhat special, because this meander could also consider as the irreducible. Yes, thank you for the question. We think that meander is said to be reducible if its order is bigger than 3. Because here it also can... Да, но змеи вот мы известны.
Поэтому там, несмотря на то, что в начале колонки нули стоят, числа не нулевые, потому что эти числа...
Да. Но формула.
А то есть, значит, вот до семи вершин, семи точек, все эти меандры раскладываются в змеи, да?
Угу. As I said, there is no good procedure to enumerate all irreducible meanders, and I use a computer program just to with a brute force algorithm. And I calculate the numbers of irreducible meanders up to 36 crossings, but it's not a big number, because the number of all meanders are known to for the n equals, I think, nearly 50. Yes. One more thing that I would like to say about the irreducible meanders is their growth rate. And
is what?
Their estimates on their growth rate. Mm-hmm. So.
By the way, do we know that the set of irreducible meanders is infinite?
Is what?
Infinite.
Yes. We know that. There are two. Okay. Let me write it first. Let us consider the following limit: leave inf. And goes to infinity. As we don't know for a reducible meander if this limit exists, we need to consider the limit fence lim sub and we have the following inequalities. Здесь у меня записано. Значит, нет, здесь у нас. From this, it easily follows that the proportion of all of irreducible meanders among all meanders with the n or less crossings tends to zero. So m n e divided by m n 0 as n goes to infinity. But as I said already, there is no good algorithm to enumerate the irreducible meanders. So for now, I know only two ways to enumerate them. One is the direct. We just draw all the meanders and try to find irreducible among them with some this is the first one. And the second one is the algorithm which I know how to use for irreducible meanders with small number of so-called caps. A cap is just an arc which connect to nearby points. So, for example, in this meander there is only three caps. And if we consider irreducible meanders with a given number of caps, we can use some kind of Euclidean algorithm for elements in the mapping class group to calculate them. But this need also a lot of additional computation for a small number of caps. It can be done, but if we have a lot of caps, I don't know an appropriate way to do it. Yes, one more remark, that this decomposition were inspired by the analogy from the knot theory, where we have the classification, well-known classification of knots, that we know that there are prime knots. Each knot is from the Schubert theorem, we know that each knot is a connected sum of prime knots. Then each prime knot is either simple, so it's toric, or it is a hyperbolic knot, and not simple prime knots are just satellite. This is a good analogy to the meander problem. Here, toric knots corresponds to snakes, and as a knot theory, toric knots are very well known. They are classified by two numbers. Snakes are also classified by it's not interesting. And the irreducible meanders correspond to the hyperbolic knots. And I gave a talk near 1 year ago in this seminar where I said that we were struggled to prove that the proportion of hyperbolic knots among all prime knots tends to zero as n tends to infinity, but we didn't achieve this goal. We only show that the proportion of all hyperbolic knots among all knots doesn't go to one. And in the case of meanders, we prove that irreducible meanders are very rare. So there are only the proportion is tends to zero. Have I any time left?
In fact, no.
Ну вот есть одна статья на архиве, но она такая очень не очень подробная. Я сейчас дописываю нормальную статью.
Ну, все-таки дайте.
Это на архиве ваших?
Да, да, да.
Ну, напишите, там же не только вы.
Ну да, там с Малютиным вместе. А вот который сейчас это. Значит. Малютин. On ergodic meanders growth rate. At the beginning of the study of this decomposition, I called irreducible meanders ergodic, but someone explained me that it's not a good definition.
Yeah, and I was puzzled with the name.
Yeah, and now we name that we say that meander is irreducible instead of defining it as ergodic ones. And I believe that the paper with more details and lots of examples and pictures will be written soon. It's by myself on irreducible meanders in preparation. Yes, just a quick remark about the I've said about that the number of meanders can be expressed in the in terms of number of irreducible meanders, but we can as irreducible meanders are hard to calculate, we can look at the meanders which don't have irreducible components in its decomposition. And these meanders are called iterated snakes. And there is also a formula which which Maxim Eduardovich asked me about now. And its formula is more easy, and we can use it to calculate the number of meanders up to, I don't know, 100 crossings or even more. So, but it's a subclass of meanders, and it's also be known to be that the number of iterated snakes among all meanders goes to zero. But as you see from this picture, from this table, for small n, the iterated snakes are almost all the meanders. Yeah, I think that's all.
Okay, thanks. More questions. Whether these estimates for the number of irreducible meanders produce better estimates for the total number of meanders?
Unfortunately, no. Because the formula for the number of all meanders is quite big, and I don't know how to use this estimate to improve the estimate on the total number of meanders.
So it is not true that the language of meanders can be considered as the one where irreducible meanders as well as snakes are irreducible words.
I don't know.
Because if usually if we have a language with a unique production, with a unique production, then that's a respectively easy way to compare growth of rates for reducible words and for all words.
No, I don't know.
You didn't try the.
In fact, this decomposition makes a so-called operate structure on the set of the meanders, but it, for me it's hard operate, so I can't make any good theorems from this structure for now.
There is a paper by Zurich and others on meanders, and as far as I remember, they enumerate the meanders with small number of caps.
In this paper, there is a they find the exact asymptotics for all meanders with a given number of caps.
Yeah.
And the fact that
have you compared your results with theirs?
I'm trying to do it. There is a conjecture that, in fact, if we fix the number of caps, the proportion of irreducible meanders tends to one. Mm. But I'm not able to prove it now.
Yeah, I see. Are there any other questions, comments?
I want to ask, so with every meander we can associate a tree, do graph homologies tell us something about meander? Every meander we can associate graph.
Not a tree, a graph, you mean?
Yes, yes, graph.
Well, I don't know. I don't think. Maybe it, we can do it. It's an interesting question. I'll try to think about it. Thank you.
More questions?
I want to ask. So let's consider projective plane, projective line, and the curve in that plane. And by Bezos theorem, we know that intersection equals the number of degree of curve. So somehow we can consider, it seems like, a meander. And can we realize, first question, can we realize arbitrary meander in such algebra, geometric?
Can we realize an arbitrary meander in what way?
If we work with algebraic curves and algebraic lines in projective plane.
I don't know the answer.
Okay. Then thanks, Yura, for a very clear talk with one more approach to the attack to the meander problem. I believe the problem is not only interesting and easier to understand, but important. And probably it provides some models in statistical physics that are not solvable yet, and but seem to be important anyway. Thank you. Thank you.